central laws falling in the concurrent list, they need president's approval.
In one sense, the Honorable Prime Minister and the BJP should thank the Punjab government because they have given the BJP and the central leadership of BJP another chance, another opportunity to rectify the historic blunder which they did in September.
Taking a cue from Congress-ruled states, the left-ruled Kerala is also examining all options to oppose the central farm laws.
All the states, I mean, now unfortunately only opposition-ruled states, will and are coming together on specific issues to begin with. So these steps are moving forward, and this is an assault on federalism.
The Modi government so far has not revealed its cards.
Assembly ka jo nirnay hai, wo jab Bharat Sarkar ke paas aayega, to hum uska bariki se parikshan karenge, aur jo kisanon ke hit mein hoga, us disha mein Modi ji ke netritv mein nirnay karenge.
The country recently witnessed deadlock between center and states over GST dues. Another one, this time on farm laws, is expected in the weeks and months to come. With camera person Vinod Kumar, this is Anand Patel in New Delhi for India Today.
Let's go across to my first guest. My newsmaker tonight at the top is Manpreet Badal, Punjab's finance minister, is joining me on this constitutional tug of war now. Appreciate your joining us. Many, Manpreet Badal, are calling the Punjab government step to amend the farm laws an eyewash, including the Aam Aadmi Party leader and Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal. They claim that at the end of the day, it's the Punjab governor and the President of India who have to give their assent before you can go ahead with these amendments to farm laws. They're unlikely to do so, and therefore all this is an eyewash, an attempt to limit the damage that has been done in Punjab to the farmer.
Well, Rajdeep, before I answer your question, if I can pose a counter question to you. While the magic of Prime Minister Modi runs in every nook and corner of India, have you ever thought that why is it that in Punjab, the BJP and Prime Minister's magic does not work? And that is simply because Punjabis know how to stand up against injustice. They have never tolerated injustice. And what I'm saying has been corroborated by the Greeks, the Tatars, the Huns, the Mughals, the Afghan, and the British. So the farm laws which have been passed by Government of India last month, they're unjust. And I don't know whether your listeners would know, but the laws which were amended by the Punjab Legislative Assembly, It was a unanimous decision of that. So every opposition party, including Aam Aadmi Party, Akali Party, and of course, Captain Amarinder Singh spearheading it. And we have amended certain clauses, which if we had not, would have caused tremendous distress to the farmers of Punjab and even to the economy of the state. Agriculture is a state subject. We are perfectly within our right to do so. I'm very encouraged by the statement of the Union Agriculture Minister, who said, I have received the legislation which have been passed. I will consult with the Ministry of Home Affairs and Justice, and we will take what is in the highest interest of Punjab. So I'm actually enthused by that.
No, Mr. Badal, no one is disputing the right of a state government to pass amendments to a law on what is seen within the concurrent list of the Constitution in a state assembly. But what you haven't answered is my question, that at the end of the day, you will need the governor's approval and the president's signature. So your passing the bills doesn't mean that these amended laws will become operational. To that extent, this is being seen as only an attempt to somehow or the other assuage the anger of the farmer in Punjab.
Well, Rajdeep, I'm trying to answer this because the entire Legislative Assembly, every member of the Legislative Assembly minus two, which is the BJP, we actually walked to the governor's residence. We sat in his lawns, he met us all, and we have told him what the sense of the feeling in Punjab was. He has promised to look into that. And as I said, agriculture is a state subject. why do you want to tinker with a system which has worked so well for India in the last 50 years, which has made India not only self-sufficient, but also almost surplus? And if I can remind your listeners, there was a recent survey out which lists India in terms of hunger out of 107 nations at 94. Why would you want to risk a system of agriculture and public distribution which can put that in jeopardy? So we're not looking for any confrontation with government of India, but we are saying that, you know, with a population of 1.3 billion people, and you'll have to believe me, even if you had money in your pocket, there are not enough food stocks floating around in the international market to be able to feed 1.3 billion people. So for God's sake, you know, just think it through. It's not a question of ego. Somebody in the Niti Aayog must have framed this legislation. In a country as big and as diverse as India, there are bound to be different sizes, you know, which something which may fit Punjab may not fit some other state. So all we're saying is let it go. There is a window of opportunity for government of India to rectify this mistake. You know, mistakes can be made. So it's, I mean, this is the same thing which they said about Notbandi or GST or some other political decisions, which I don't want to actually rake up just now.
No, but, you know, Manpreet Badal, your amended law guarantees the minimum support price for wheat and paddy farmers. That's what you've done. You've essentially made it almost like a right that the farmers have to ensure they get the minimum support price. Now, there will be those who say at the end of the day, Punjab is still stuck in the mandi culture. You are still catering to vested interests of certain farmer groups. Why not assure MSP for all farmers? Why for a particular group of wheat and paddy farmers? How do you respond?
Rajdeep, unfortunately, Punjab has got into a system of monoculture, which is wheat and rice. All that the Punjab bills are saying, that if any private trader or any corporate wants to come to Punjab to buy food grains, he has to buy it at the minimum support price, which has been set by Government of India or the CACP. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there's nothing, you know, wrong or confrontationist about this, that whatever is the minimum support price, if a private individual or a private entity or a company or a corporate wants to buy wheat and rice from Punjab, they have to buy it at MSP. Number two, if anybody wants to trade in food grains in Punjab, and by food grains, I only mean wheat and rice, he has to have a license. He has to be within some kind of government regulation. You know, he can't be just, you know, having traders, and what this law says, that you just come, have a PAN card, you can buy it at the back of the street. That would not be allowed in Punjab. And lastly, any purchase of food grains has to be done from designated market yards. That's all Punjab is saying. More than that.
But Manpreet Badal, why not extend these MSP benefits to other farmers as well? Why do you continue with the monoculture of rice and wheat only? Shouldn't Punjab be diversifying? Shouldn't all farmers be diversifying? It's only in Punjab we find these kind of protests taking place, really.
Government of Punjab, in fact, is promoting diversification in a very large way. In fact, Punjab would, in the years to come, would be the principal state from where not only would we be growing food grains, but actually the principal producer of quality seeds, certified seeds. That would be done from Punjab. Milk, potatoes, if your listeners, and some of them would know, that most of the potato which is sown in India, the seed comes from Punjab, because we are blessed with an agroclimate where potato seeds come out virus free. So Punjab is we're trying to diversify agriculture, but at the moment the dependence is largely on food grains. And also, if I can remind you, Rajdeep, while Punjab is only 1.5% of India's total land mass, yet we're producing about 38% of India's food surpluses. You don't want to jeopardize this. That's all I'm trying to say.
The Modi government says it's not jeopardizing Punjab's agriculture future. What they are claiming is that the new farm laws are opening up agriculture. Why should farmers' choices be limited to where the state to the state-run mandis? Why not liberalize farm sector? Let farmers sell to private producers if they so wish. The new laws will prevent those private will de-incentivize the new Punjab laws will de-incentivize the farm the private producers.
Rajdeep, surely this is not constricting agriculture. If the government were to say that anybody coming into Punjab, please buy at the minimum support price. I mean, is that trying to somehow, would it be in the interest of the farmer that someone comes and buys his produce below MSP? And will it be that, you know, if we discourage fly-by-night operators who come and, you know, 86% of all the farmers of Punjab, 86%, that's a fairly high figure, have only 5 acres of land. They are not in a position to actually, have a favorable bargain with a corporate entity or, private enterprise. All that the government is doing is to actually protect the interest of the farmer. Rajdeep, we may have our political outlooks or, opinions. Believe me, the Kisan is a pretty sensible man. He realizes where his benefit and loss is. You'll have to convince him. And the arguments of Government of India don't convince him at this very moment.
One final question. Let's assume that the president and the governor don't accede to your amended laws. Will you then move the Supreme Court? Will this battle, as I said, eventually reach the courts, this constitutional face-off that is brewing?
Whatever has to be done in the highest interest of the welfare of the farmers of Punjab and for the government of Punjab, we will walk every inch of the way.
Okay. Manpreet Badal, Finance Minister of Punjab, saying that the Punjab government will do whatever it takes to ensure that the farmers' interests are protected. Appreciate your joining us here on the news today. Constitutional face-off, is that now inevitable, is my first big question. Can states simply nullify central laws? Will the Modi government block Punjab's farm laws? Are we therefore heading for a confrontation between the centre and the Congress-ruled states in particular? I'm joined by Nalin Kohli, BJP spokesperson. Also joining me is Sunil Jakhad, chief of the Punjab Congress, and Siddharth Luthra, senior advocate, to understand the constitutional position. First, let's come to Nalin Kohli to respond, because Nalin Kohli, the sense now is that the Congress-ruled states are saying, you did not consult us before passing these farm laws. We believe these farm laws that you have passed at the center are anti-farmer. We therefore reserve the right to amend them. How do you respond? The lack of consultation, you might have heard Manpreet Badal suggesting this is very much like what happened with Notbandi. You pass something which can have an effect on millions. Should they not have been consulted?
Well, that's what Parliament is for, Rajdeep. Anything that's passed in Parliament is basically based on a discussion, and it's a whole parliamentary process. Now, if someone decides not to participate in that, the onus doesn't fall on the government, because the government introduces in Parliament, and thereafter what happens has to be part of that discussion or
that
process.
But it's the states who are affected. Sorry to intervene, Nalin Kohli. You pass it in Parliament, but it's affected the states. Why could the Prime Minister not have called, let's say, a meeting of all the chief ministers, all the agriculture ministers, before you pass a law? Because now, if these laws are being bypassed or challenged, you could be heading for a confrontation.
No, I think confrontation is part of democracy also. Here, the Congress party and the Congress-ruled states are choosing that path. The Prime Minister and the BJP aren't. I ask myself a simple question. Since when has choice become a problem? Has anyone dismantled the agricultural mandis? Has anyone dismantled the APMC structure? Has these acts of Parliament or this in any way said that the MSP will not be there? Has MSP not been increased by the Government of India? At the moment also, as we speak, is it not being procured? I am unable to understand that what existed exists. There is no change. What has happened is more choices there. And under trade, which is on the concurrent list, you've opened up agriculture to farmers who wish to take the benefit under that. If they want to go to the APMCs, as they may wish in Punjab or anywhere else, they will go because it's not dismantled. So here's a case that I'm unable to understand. Since when has choice? become a problem. So today, if you can go and buy one shirt in one shop at a fixed rate, tomorrow, if you are offered a choice to also go to another shop, where is that in any way prejudicing anybody's interests? This is a political...
Sunit Jaja, respond to what Nalin Kohli is saying. I think effectively what he is claiming and what the central government is claiming is that you and others, and you, I mean the opposition, is basically misleading the farmers to suggest that these central laws would mean the end of the minimum support price. According to the government, if anything, they have raised the support price in recent weeks for rice and wheat. So why is the Congress, are the Congress-ruled governments crying foul at a time when, according to the government, all they are doing is opening up choices? You can go to the private producer, you can go to the state mandi.
Rajdeep ji, when I hear Nalin Kohli ji, I basically hear the arrogance of majority, that they have passed it in the parliament, that this should be the writ which should run across the country, but it is not so. What we have passed in Punjab Assembly yesterday is not just a piece of legislation. It is a collective voice of the collective will of people of Punjab. And when we talk about why should we not take Mr. Nalin Kohli or even the Honorable Prime Minister's word at its face value that they say MSP was there, is here and will remain, is because it's not written in the paper, in the these three laws which they have passed in the parliament. It is what the Shanta Kumar committee said. And it is what our one of the most senior most ministers in the BJP government, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, said a few days after these bills were passed on, notified on, ordinances were notified on the 5th of June. And he said this continuation of government purchase of food grain at MSP is a burden on Indian economy. This shows the mindset of the BJP party. Rajdeep, this is, if it is a matter of point of view. If you look at farming as a trade opportunity, then that's your view. Mm-hmm. But for us, it's a way of life. And even for when you dislocate a small village, when a dam is being built or some factory comes in and everybody asks for a kind of a, what you call a social impact survey should be done. And here what we are trying to do is we are going to do away with the entire way of life.
Sunil Jakhar ji, there is nothing in the legislation which says the government is doing away with MSP. Let's be very clear. You can argue that the bill does not say specifically that MSP must be is a statutory right. But it wasn't a statutory right even when the Congress was in power. My limited point, bill that leads you to believe that the government is removing MSP? Where is it removing it?
They are giving a non-level playing field to the corporates. That's the problem. The same arguments were advanced when Airtel and all these people were Jio Telecom was brought in, and what they have done to BSN and all. All they came in was that we're giving free kind of a unbelievable prices to the telecom consumers. And look what have they done. Once you have a monopoly, this is very well known, this kind of the corporates with the financial strength will run down all these APMCs in maybe a couple of years. It's not being done tomorrow. They have to first build up a structure, a whole setup to handle these kind of a food grains. But you also know, everybody in sitting in Bombay and Ahmedabad knows that the after pharmaceutical industry, it is the food grain trade which has the highest profit margins. They want to eat into this and they want to take over. The fight, as you said, is a battle not between center and states. It's a battle between the farmers and the corporates. They are trying to corporatize the farming sector. What Modi ji started with, Rajdeep ji, he started saying that Congress Mukt Bharat. Now what he is trying to do is he is doing Kisan Mukt Kisani. Kisani rahegi, kisan nahi rahega. There will be, can you imagine one of these big industrial houses running farms up? Where what will happen to all these people? Okay, who has ever talked to them?
Okay, and if they're so convinced, you believe that this is the fear of the future? It's been said before by others also who oppose the bill. I take your point. Nalin Kohli, you want a quick response before I go to Mr. Luthra for the constitutional position? There is a sense that, again, it comes back to it. There's a fear, and it's a fear that a farmer has at the end of the day, that a year, 4 or 5 years down the line, the entire process of procurement of food grains will get corporatized. That this is the first step towards it. And that could, particularly for the small and marginal farmer, leave him almost in a situation where he's dependent on these corporates?
And also, please ask, do we believe Mr. Gadkari or should we believe Mr. Tomar?
Okay. Go ahead, Nalin, respond.
I think this is a new way of looking at it. I personally respect Mr. Jhakar. I know him also. And I respect the family and their contribution to the Indian, to development in India. But I think that's also not correct. I mean, now are we saying, is Sunil Jhakar ji suggesting that Mr. Gadkari can't have a point of view? So Article 19 applies to the Congress leadership. It doesn't apply to anybody in the BJP. Well, let's go back to the law. Where does this act anywhere say that it's dismantling the APMC or MSP? And then the proof of the pudding is in eating it. Agricultural budget was 25 to 30,000 crores when Prime Minister Modi came in 14. Today, it is almost 1,50,000 crores. 10 crore farmers have received 94,000 crores in terms of the transfer under Kisan directly into account. The MSP has gone up for rice, for soya bean, for wheat, for pulses. Hing is not even grown in this country. Can you believe it? As of it, India, we import 750 crores of it every year, 1,200 tons. And it comes from Iran, Afghanistan, and Uzbekistan. India couldn't even do cultivation of asafoetida. Now, finally, we are looking that we should cultivate it in the high reaches of whether it's Lahul Spiti or whether it is in Ladakh. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's easy to sit down and give a lot of gyan, which is what the Congress party does, without looking at the performance or the track record of a government. Prime Minister Modi's government is a government that performs. What they are doing is trying to create a constitutional crisis. Because an act let of parliament, level of constitution, what they are doing is purposely creating a situation which, in my estimate, and I'm sure Siddharth Lutraji will probably expand as a senior lawyer, is that they are trying to create a situation that something comes in the court, and as we say, that humne to koshish kiya
lekin. Let me turn to Mr. Luthra. Nalin Kohli, let me turn to Mr. Luthra. Siddharth Lutra, are we heading for a constitutional crisis if all the Congress-ruled states decide to amend the farm laws and bring in their own farm laws? Because agriculture, markets and lands, Mr. Luthra, are state subjects under entries 14, 18 and 22 of the 7th schedule of the Constitution. Therefore, the states can frame laws covering them. The centre has introduced the farm reform bills under entry 33 of the concurrent list that allows the central governments to frame laws on the control of production, supply and distribution of products of any industry, including agriculture. How do you see this? Can states independently of the center frame their own laws or amend central laws, or will they now need necessarily presidential assent?
I must tell you, Rajiv, the position is very well settled. The Constitution provides under Article 246 that while each legislature has its own domain, in the event of a conflict, it is very clear that to the extent that there is an overlap, the central law will prevail, and that's the fundamental constitutional principle. Mm-hmm. Having said that, even if the state law gets presidential assent, we will have to see, put it to what we call in law, the pith and substance test. Is there an overlap? And to the extent that there is an overlap, the state law will have to give way to the central law. Today, you have a situation, though the central law has come under the concurrent list, the central law is in existence. We are reaching, unfortunately, I believe, a situation of constitutional indiscipline where legislatures are not respecting each other's domains and jurisdictions. Of course, these matters will at some point be taken up in court by one party or the other. But I think it is more important that the language of the Constitution is so clear. It's been settled not once, but a million times. And today happening
Mr.
is...
But Mr. Luthra, agriculture, markets and lands are state subjects. Are you telling me that the Punjab Assembly, Rajasthan Assembly, Chhattisgarh Assembly, Maharashtra Assembly cannot frame their own amended laws?
No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that to the extent that it is covered by a law which is framed by the center, the overlap will not work. And that is what has to be seen if there's an overlap. Because if you look at Article 246, it's very clear. Legislature can make power, but subject to 1 and 3 of 246. Sub-article 2 of 246 says Parliament has the power to make laws. Now the whole point here is Parliament has made a law. Mm-hmm. Legislature has its own laws. Mm-hmm. Now one aspect is if they both operate in different domains, they will coexist if they operate parallelly. Mm-hmm. But if there is an overlap, then the central law will prevail. And there is, of course, as you rightly said earlier, there is also the issue of the presidential assent that will be required if it's under if necessary. So these are issues which will have to be seen.
Right.
And the concern that I believe is, as you had pointed out, that this matter eventually is heading towards court. I don't think it's a constitutional crisis, but definitely it's going to land up in court, and it's and the ultimate victim or the ultimate loss will be to the poor farmer, because if parallel mechanisms exist, whether it is one or the other, we can't have the MSP going away, as has been pointed out by you very clearly. So therefore, even if the laws have been brought in by the center, there has to be a mechanism for ensuring that the whole purpose of agriculture is not lost on one-upmanship.
Can I just take that to you, Mr. Jakhad, as a final word? Are you inevitably, I ask this to Manpreet Badal as well, are you determined in a way that if necessary, this must go to the court? Let the court settle it, the domain of whether the state has the domain to pass laws when it comes to agriculture?
Rajdeep ji, I believe they have, center has its authority, but every authority, at least in an authority through democratic means, has equal amount of responsibility also. We have fulfilled, our state government has fulfilled the responsibility towards Punjab and towards its farmers. And we do not expect our central government to just exercise the authority and not be responsible. We are integral part of India. The farmers of Punjab have delivered, even in spite of all the obstacles and whatever happened in COVID and every other circumstance, Punjab has delivered. Why do you want to undo what is a proven thing? Why do you want to recreate the wheel?
Right.
There may be some lacunas which can be fixed. But all we need is a patient hearing that there are fundamental flaws. There's one particular thing, if you have a moment, Rajiv ji, when you talk about MSP, MSP regime staying or not staying is different thing. There are two separate things about MSP. MSP is one, fixing of the price. Purchase at MSP is a different story altogether. Of all the 23 crops for MSP, which is fixed, only two crops, paddy and wheat, is being purchased at MSP. Rest everything is selling far below MSP. So what we are concerned is government purchased, open-ended government purchase, which is happening in Punjab. We are protecting what is with us right now, what we have. We are not trying to work towards the church's dream of having MSP for every product, which is, I don't know when will that be possible.
Well, there will be those farmers, as I told, there will be those farmers, as I told Punjab.
We are not looking for a confrontation. Last thing.
Yes.
If they do not want to talk to the farmers who were invited, then I would request all the seven ministers who have been assigned to go out, if they can hold rallies in Bihar, they should come here to talk to Punjab farmers themselves rather than holding a webinar. Why are they so scared of?
So that I think a simpler way, why can't the Prime Minister possibly invite all the chief ministers and the agriculture ministers and settle this? This can be settled surely through consultation and not confrontation. The last thing we need in the times in which we live is more confrontation in our politics. Nalin Kohli, Sunil Jakhad, Siddharth Luthran, good to have a discussion without the noise of news. Thank you very much for explaining each point of view so clearly and lucidly. Let's turn to the other big story that's coming in today. Breaking news that's coming in a day after India Today exposed COVID protocol violations at political rallies in Bihar. Remember, we carried a series of pictures yesterday. The Election Commission has stepped in. It's reprimanded political parties, asked the electoral officers and district officials in Bihar to act against all candidates and organizers who are not following COVID protocols. Remember, in many rallies, no masks, no social distancing, and those overcrowded rallies have become a source of worry in Bihar at a time like this. Joining me now is our correspondent Aishwarya Paliwal from Delhi. Aishwarya, what exactly is the Election Commission planning to do? Because how many such rallies can they monitor? And they've known this. Why did it require all of us to put it out on TV for the Election Commission to wake up?
Well, I think that definitely is a very big question. The question at the moment is, how will the Election Commission sitting in Delhi make sure what is happening in Bihar does not continue? Now, from what we understand, the CEO of Bihar has been given very clear instructions. The district, the DEOs, the district election officers have been given very clear instructions today to make sure every protocol is followed. Let me also tell you, PECI is saying the guidelines were given out on the 21st of August, which clearly means officials in Bihar had ample time. The other thing very important, Rajdeep, to note is that all the guidelines were made after consultation with political parties. So it's not as if political parties did not know what the guidelines were. Now, from what we understand, from tomorrow, we will see a clampdown on these kind of rallies. What the punishment will be?
No, actually, I'm trying to understand what can they do. The Prime Minister is going to hold a dozen rallies over the next 10 days in Bihar. You can expect even larger crowds possibly for Prime Minister Modi's rallies. What happens? Can the Election Commission tell the BJP that this is unacceptable, or tell in Tejaswi's case that the RJD has to control the crowds? Who's going to control the crowds?
See, what really needs to happen, the officials on ground are the ones who now need to make sure guidelines are followed. But what they can actually do, they have evoked Disaster Management Act. They are saying from Section 51 to Section 60, which means imprisonment up to 1 year, fine or both. This is what very clearly the Election Commission in the letter that they have sent to political parties today is saying. So that is also a possibility that could also happen. But at the moment, manpower is what is required, Rajdeep, on the ground. The onus now actually lies with the CEO of Bihar. He will have to make sure all the guidelines are adhered to. Right. Otherwise, we could see the ECI stepping in and taking some action against all the political parties involved in the Bihar election, Rajdeep.
Aishwarya Paliwal, for giving us a sense of what the Election Commission is likely to do. Thank you very much for joining me on that story. Let's turn from there to our ground report, which also comes from Bihar. Now, in our poll, the Lok Niti CSTS poll, one thing has come out very clearly. Unemployment this time is a major issue in the Bihar elections. Remember, Bihar's youth unemployment rate at the moment is the highest in the country. And Bihar's leader of the opposition and the RJD's chief ministerial face, Tejaswi Yadav, has decided to make unemployment his calling card. He's claiming that he will give 10 lakh jobs if he is voted to power. Can he actually do that? Ankit Tyagi has been catching up with Tejaswi Yadav on the campaign trail.
Driven by Hyundai Smart Cars for Smart India.
Tejaswi, opposition is raising the question. Opposition बार बार यही सवाल पूछ रहा है आपसे 10 लाख का वादा करते हैं जनता रिस्पॉन्ड करती है 10 लाख नौकरी आएगी कहाँ
नीतीश जी हाथ खड़े कर रहे हैं वो नहीं दे पा रहे नौकरियां खाली पड़ी हुई हैं रिक्त है सरकारी नौकरियां जिसको हम लोगों ने कमिटमेंट के साथ हम लोगों ने संकल्प लिया उसको पूरा करें
आज आप एलजेपी के सांसद से भी मिले
सरकार बनने जा रही है एनडीए का सफाया निश्चित है
एलजेपी के सांसद से मिले चिराग एंड तेजस्वी कमिंग ऑन अ सिंगल प्लेटफॉर्म नाउ
ये ऐसी कोई बात नहीं
But how is this unemployment issue actually playing out on the ground? Ankit Tyagi is at ground zero. He spoke to many people, including laborers, migrants, about the Nitish government and the unemployment, which is now a major issue in this election. Take a look at his ground report.
सब बंदी हो जा रहा था हम लोग जिएंगे किससे?
I in Patna at the Labour Chowk. It's about 11:30 right now. By this time, you will hardly find any labourer. And this is true for most of what is known in possibly every town and city as the Labour Chowk. Because they come here at 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock in the morning. And usually construction labourers, Rajmistris, labourers, all of them would get picked up, would get employed and will leave this place. At this point of time at the Labour Chowk here, you will see about 50, 60 labourers here waiting for the work. And most of them will tell you about an absolutely back-breaking, extraordinary, lack of employment, economic hardship that they have been facing. आप लोगों को महीने में पहले कितने दिन काम मिलता था, अब कितने दिन काम मिल रहा है?
पहले महीने में हम लोग को 20-25 रोज काम मिल जाता था
लॉकडाउन से पहले
हाँ लॉकडाउन से पहले अब सर करीब करीब 2-3 रोज मिल जा रहा है तो बहुत कठिन है
कितना पैसा मिलता था लॉकडाउन से पहले एक दिन के
काम करते थे तो सर राजमिस्त्री का मिलता था 600 रुपया और लेबर का 400 रुपया सर
लेबर का 400 रुपया
जी सर
और अब कितना पैसा मिलता है
अभी तो सर 400 में चल जा रहा है मिस्त्री 500 में मिल रहा है खखन में जा रहा है भूखे के चलते जो मिल रहा है जो में चल जा रहा है हम लोग
वोट डालते हैं आप लोग?
जी सर, वोट डालते हैं।
वोट डालते हैं कि नहीं डालेंगे इस साल?
नहीं डालेंगे।
नहीं डालेंगे कैसे, भूखे प्यासे मरेंगे, पैदल चल जाएंगे घर पर, पैसा कौड़ी है ये नहीं है तो क्या करेंगे? नहीं डालेंगे, कोई कहीं वोट डालेंगे ऐसी कर छोड़ देंगे।
गाड़ी से खाना लेके आते थे, वही बांटते थे तो हम लोग खाते थे।
खाना बांटते हैं
जी?
और दोनों
बांटते थे, अब बंद हो गया दो तीन महीना से खाना। पहले हम
खाना बांटने के लिए गाड़ी से लाइन से लगा के गरीब लोग को खाना देते थे, अब तो वही आना जाना बंद हो गया।
All of them only have one thing. They used to make their living for about 20 days in a month before the lockdown. Post lockdown, it has come down to 2 to 3 in 15 days, 2 to 3 days of work in 15 days. All of them only wanting to make an honest living, but extremely angry at the plight where they have been now left at. Many believe the government should have done more. All schemes are only left on the papers. For them, at the end of the day, it's just despair and hopelessness.
From the Boring Canal Road, we make our way 3 kilometers away, under the Sipra Railway Bridge, another spot where daily wages assemble to find work.
मैं खुद इधर 3 महीने से रह के देख रहा हूँ स्कूल के नीचे। मैं बंबई में 10 साल से रहता था।
आप यहाँ पे काम किधर आए?
हाँ, काम करने आया, जब से लॉकडाउन बंद हुआ मैं इधर काम मजबूरी में होटल पे काम करना पड़े। बंबई में 10 साल काम किया
तो कितना पैसा मिलता था
तुमको? उधर रिलायंस में भी मैं काम किया, उसमें 10,000 देता था 8 घंटे का। सेठ उधर बोल रहे हैं कि ट्रेन नहीं चालू है, सेठ से बात हो रहा है लेकिन वो बोलते हैं ट्रेन चालू होगा तभी तुमको बुला सकते हैं।
क्या काम
करते हो? वही प्लेट धोता है, लिट्टी चोखा बनाता है, वो क्या करता है? प्लेट धोता है, लिट्टी चोखा समोसा बनाता है होटल में।
कितना पैसा मिलता है?
100 रुपए 150 रुपए मिलता है
रोज का,
14 घंटा 15 घंटा ड्यूटी करके।
हम लोग के मिला है।
पहले घर पे पैसा भेजते थे 8-10 हजार रुपए में,
सभी से भेजता था 2,500 रुपए लगाता था उस टाइम से,
हर महीने। अभी कैसे 150 रुपए में क्या बचा?
अभी 150 में बस खा के रह जा रहा हूँ, कहाँ घर पे पैसा नहीं भेज पा रहा हूँ मैं।
इसी के वोट नहीं देंगे, अपने मर्जी से
भूखे के लिए लोग नदी नाला घूमने जाते हैं, वहाँ जाते हैं, मस्जिद आता है, अभी हेलीकॉप्टर से प्रचार कर रहे हैं वहाँ कर रहे। कौन गरीब लोग मरता है उसको देखने आया क्या?
बड़ी भाभी के
रोते हैं, भूखे रोते हैं ये लोग। दे दो भैया खाना, दे दो हाथ पे, होटल पे आके मांगते हैं।
भाभी को 4,000 लेके
बच्चे रोते हैं, लगते सबको वोट मांगने के लिए आ जाते हैं। अरे नगर सेवक होकर हम कौन, कोई कुछ नहीं करता है।
Many are now resorting to whatever odd jobs they can find in desperation to make ends meet.
पहले राजमिस्त्री का काम,
मिस्त्री का काम करता हूँ सर। अभी काम नहीं मिल रहा था हम सर, कबाड़ी बोरा में बोतल भरता हूँ सर। डेली का हमको काम करते थे तो हमको डेली का 550 रुपया मिल जाता था सर, बेगाड़ी। और अभी चुनता हूँ तो हमको 100-150 भी नहीं आता है सर। परिवार कहाँ से चलेंगे सर, इसमें तो खाने के लिए अपने पेट भरने के लिए तो पैसा नहीं होता है, तो कहाँ से परिवार चलेंगे?
वोट डालने जाएंगे?
जब हम लोग मर जाएंगे तो वोट डालने कौन जाएगा?
This is a desperation that cannot be expressed in words. I don't know which way this election is going, but I know one thing for sure. This is an extraordinary election of a time, at a time when there is extraordinary economic distress. I don't know how much of an impact it is going to have on the votes, but the anger is palpable and the anger is against the government. Krishkiran Sangpal, Ankit Tyagi in Patna, India Today.
Welcome back. Let's turn to our good news story today. And today it comes once again from Jharkhand. We're traveling to a village which has started cultivating drumsticks on barren land. That's not all. They're even now exporting it across the world. This is a classic example of Atmanirbhar Jharkhand. Take a look.
Pandemic, reverse migration, job losses. Rural India is reeling under tremendous financial pain. But a few villages near Ranchi have taken the challenge head on and have come up trumps. People of Piska Nagri, Bhora Toli and nearby villages have taken to cultivating drumsticks on barren land. And their produce is now being exported to different parts in India, as well as Dubai, Sri Lanka and the Netherlands.
हम लोग बंजर जमीन में ये पौधा को लगा के आज 4 से 5 फीट बढ़ा चुके हैं,
जो कि आज हम लोग को जो फलेगा तो हम लोग को बहुत फायदा होगा और फायदा के अनुसार हमारा घर परिवार आनंद और खुशी से चलने पाएगा।
They got a helping hand from a farmer producer organization.
किसानों को कम लागत लगाते थे उतना भी मुनाफा नहीं हो पाता था तो हमने सोचा कि एफपीओ बनाने के लिए फिर बनाए उसमें एक एक करके सारे जो हमारे ग्रुप में महिला है उसे जोड़े और खेती को उपजाऊ जो हुआ उसे एक बार दुबई भेजे विदेश भेजे और यहाँ से 3 गुना मुनाफा हुआ उसे हमारे जो सहयोगी एफपीओ के साथियाँ हैं सब बहुत खुश हुए और इसी से हमारा मनोबल बढ़ा।
The villagers are now hoping for help from the state or center to grow their venture. Bureau Report, India Today.